At the beginning of the school year, our teacher pitched us an idea of a culminating project for our environmental science and policy class.
This idea was called Project Atlantic, a project our town energy committee was working on when the class started.
Project Atlantic was created as a way to study European energy models and see how they deal with energy efficiency, and as a means of exploring how Brattleboro can incorporate those models.
Project Atlantic is meant to inspire and inform the Brattleboro community about how we can reduce fossil fuel dependence and costs by finding alternative, environmentally friendly energy resources.
I slope in my blondie by the sun, now orange and white, dark red, green and yellow. Rainbow colors, tonight I see the view. Slip as I go through. I kiss the light, the storm, the wild beast. Everything bright, your song burning seems. The look in your eyes, break up once into a scream and shout into a.
Could ask you basically how the town uses its energy.
Well, the town is a purchaser of energy of a wide variety of different energies. Obviously, we maintain a number of facilities, and our facilities are either heated with fuel oil or liquid propane. We consume electricity at virtually all of our locations. We consume electricity through our street lights that we maintain. And in addition to that, we provide a number of fleets to each of the different departments. So the fire department runs fire trucks, and so we purchase diesel, gasoline, and the same holds true for the police department, public works, parks and rec, all over the
place. The big message that we want to get out is we are always looking at ways of improving. you know, always looking at different ways to, you know, when you use a lot of energy at the Nelson Wood and Cascading facility, between the propane and we do, you know, the electrical, you know, what is the most cost-effective way? So we'll get anywhere, and we're always trying to make those make our decisions, in, you know, working with the budgets we have and moving in that direction. And not just there, but in all of our parks.
Explored by many European countries is the use of district heating as an alternative. Here is Nicole to tell you more about how this could be implemented in Brattleboro.
Just a little heat.
District heating is a way to warm residential and commercial areas by producing and distributing heat from a centralized location. The heat is often created in a cogeneration plant, which is the use of a power station or heat engine to generate electricity and useful heat at the same time.
A district heating network is comprised of three things: a boiler, a network of pre-insulated pipes, and a building that is in need of heating. The boiler is capable of making cold air for AC units and can be powered by fossil fuels, recuperation fuels, or renewables. The pipes are then connected to the structure through a power station and used to heat your home, work, or public buildings.
There are many advantages to a district heating system, and some of them are as follows. In the long term, costs would be slowly reduced and CO2 emissions would go down. There is a low environmental impact due to heat recycling and the use of renewable energies like solar and wood. There is also no concern about fuel availability for certain customers because this type of system could run off of renewables. In conclusion, there are very low maintenance costs, it's a very reliable type of heating, and has very low risks.
We're all a much more efficient way to do things. It's also, if we can use a renewable fuel like wood instead of using fossil fuel like oil, that's a real big plus in my mind as well.
With advantages come disadvantages, which include ownership, cost, time, and availability. With a large-scale operation, it would be hard to determine who was going to own certain parts of the system and maintain them as well. It would cost a lot of money to install a system anywhere. In St. Paul, Minnesota, their system costs $70 to $80 million. It would take a couple of years to build a complete system and would take even longer to see results. District heating would only be available where a network of pipes would be located. Drake Landing Solar Community is the first of its kind in North America. The 52-home neighborhood uses a district heating system designed to store solar energy underground during the summer to fulfill space heating needs in the winter. In addition to solar space heating, two panels located on the roof of the home provide 60% of the home's domestic hot water requirements.
Meantime, I mean, there are smaller district heating projects, I call them mini district heating projects, going on. Jason Cooper, who's a private landlord, has made one district heating district for five of his buildings, and there are 20 different apartments in those five buildings.
Jason's buildings were using about 10,000 gallons of oil per year for a little over 20 units and had about $35 to $40 a year in fuel costs. He did the math and found that a wood pellet heat system would cost much less and decided to switch the oil furnace in his office building to one. He then decided to connect four more buildings to the pellet burner over the next few years. He told me that he substantially reduced his heating costs for those five buildings. In 2009, Montpelier had a feasibility study on whether a district heating system could work in the city. In January of 2010, the town was awarded a grant of $8 million to build a district energy plant that would create heat and power to make the community more efficient and more dependent on renewables over fossil fuels. The town spent an estimated $25 million on their system for the downtown buildings, which include the Capitol building, and had little left to be done in October of 2013. Brattleboro Union High School is an Energy Star school that uses a form of biomass district heating. The system involves burning wood chips to get the heat for the high school, middle school, and career center buildings. I sat down with Robert Clark, who is the coordinator of heat in our school.
Brattleboro Union High School District Number 6 are all heated from a central heating facility, and we are a biomass school, which means we burn wood chips. And the piping is all underground, and that feeds the separate buildings. And that water transfers into baseboard radiation, goes around the perimeter of the building.
As far as where Brattleboro might be heading with district energy and district heating, it depends a lot on the price of heating oil. A lot of people feel like the price of heating oil is going to go up and stay up. And there's a lot of evidence for that. So when that happens, we have a lot of information to take the next steps. Done by Morris Pierce, the person who came to town from upstate New York. And so he was looking at a facility called the Brattleboro Kiln Dry down on Front Street and whether that could tie into the hospital. So he was sort of proposing that as a phase one. And in that tie-in, you have other users sort of on that route that might also, you know, be able to tie in. From there, he proposed to spread it to a lot more of the sort of south side of Brattleboro, where the high school is located, but also a number of other buildings and some of the industrial buildings are located and they could tap in as well. So I think that was his phase two. A lot of his phase three had to do with downtown Main Street, which includes, you know, some of the town-owned buildings as well as a state-owned building or two and the retreat facility as well.
Small district heating projects can be found all over Brattleboro, and I hope to see a town-wide system in the future. Thank you for watching.
Here's Zizi to tell you more about how we can strive for greater efficiency in our homes.
So I'm going home.
Efficiency can be used on a larger scale as well. Many of our large buildings and institutions suffer from inefficient infrastructure.
The term energy efficient is widely used today, and while there are many different ideas and definitions of what being energy efficient is, it all comes down to one simple concept: producing the same amount of energy but using less electricity or power to do so. To help us understand what it takes to make buildings more energy efficient, we looked at Brattleboro Union High School as our source, one of the most energy efficient buildings in Brattleboro and the state of Vermont.
I'm here today with Robert Clark, the facility manager here at BUHS, who is responsible for making our building more energy efficient. Hello, Robert.
Hi, how are you?
Would you like to give us an overview of your job, what you do here?
So, like I said, I'm Robert Clark. I'm the facility manager at Brattleboro Union High School. I've been working here for 14 years. And my job is the integration of people, place, process, and technology. I take all these things, bring it together, and support the core business function, which is education.
Robert Clark felt it was not only his, but everyone's responsibility to take care of the environment and save energy.
I saw the electric bill, and I thought, wow, that's a lot of money. And I thought about that. And I am the facility manager. So what could I do to make this better? And not only what could I do to make this better, you think about the environment that we live in and all this electricity was coming from the Midwest with coal-fired plants polluting the atmosphere, watching programs on TV, and it really gets you thinking about where does all this electricity come from. So I just decided that as a person that is responsible for the building and responsible to the taxpayers of Brattleboro and the outlying towns, that it's my responsibility to do everything I can to lower the cost of the building and to lower the cost to the taxpayer. We started trying to make the building more cost-effective back in 2007 by removing all the metal halide fixtures in the gymnasiums. Middle school, high school, the career center had all their shops were lit by metal halide. And we removed a total of 110 fixtures and replaced them with a T8 fixture that was much more energy efficient, better light, and they all came with occupancy sensors, so when somebody walked out of the room, it would automatically shut the lights off. So, and that worked out quite well. There was a great savings in electricity from all that energy that was not being used.
To begin thinking about how to change from an energy inefficient building to an energy efficient building, Robert Clark has some suggestions.
Well, I think the hardest thing is always the beginning. It's how to get started. Who do you talk to, especially when you know little about the subject? And I was fortunate enough to contact Norm Etkins from the School Energy Management Program up north. And he came in and he did an extensive survey of the building. And he put together a report for me. And it guided me on what I should be doing, what was cost effective, big projects, little projects. And he followed up with me and asked me how I was doing and answered questions for me. So the hardest thing to do is to get started. It's like anything. It's inertia. But once you get going, it gets easier as you go along.
So efficiency-wise, how does your school match up against other schools in the area and in the country?
Well, this I'm pretty proud of, so I'm going to just hold that right up there. Brattleboro Union High School is 2013 Energy Star certified. So that means that we are in the top 25% of the country in energy performance. So I say we stack up pretty well against the other schools.
So what small steps can we make in our town to make our buildings, besides BOHS, more energy efficient?
Well, as I walk around buildings, and I'm always looking up. And I notice that even with all the education out there, there is today with lighting and how we're, you know, we have all this great LED lighting, compact fluorescent lighting that we could save energy. I walk through places and I see old fixtures in there. All the fixtures are on. Buildings are overlit. Simple things like just paying attention. People don't pay attention. Lighting is 30% of the cost of a building. If people paid more attention to their electric bills, to their fuel bills, and just looked at simple ways that they could do it, not try to get overcomplicated about it, they would be able to save energy. I think people think it's too big a thing to tackle, like they need to do too much. If you do it in small steps, anybody can save energy simply by just looking at your lighting, taking some small steps, and then continually taking small steps.
I think what we can all learn from Robert is that saving energy can be achieved just by making small, simple adjustments. Example of this could be changing to a more efficient bulb, turning off things when you're done with them, or not overlighting rooms. As Robert says, energy is saved in small steps, and anyone can save energy.
Efficiency goes beyond heating and cooling. Here are Maya and Maddie to tell you how efficiency can affect one of the largest energy users in our town.
Another major consumer of energy in our society is agriculture. The total energy consumed in U.S. farms in 2002 was 1.7 quadrillion BTUs. Here's Maggie to tell you more.
But I'd been forgotten, I'd been married a long time ago.
A farm in Bennington, Vermont is using their crops and turning them into biodiesel to fuel their farm equipment, making state line farms much more energy efficient.
In 2010, 60.5 million gallons of diesel were purchased in Vermont at an average of $3.16 a gallon, spending approximately $191 million. In order to curb the environmental impact and financial cost of this consumption, some farmers in the state have begun to produce their own biodiesel from oil seed crops grown on their land.
The biodiesel process at Stateline Biofuels begins with a harvested crop of oil seed, which is first dried and then stored in the grain hopper shown at number 1. From the hopper, it is fed by gravity to the oil mill at number 2. The mill also separates the remainder of the seed as meal. The meal is dropped into a bag at number 3. The oil is then diverted to a set of 2 55-gallon settling drums shown at number 4. The settled oil moves by gravity into a milk tank converted for use as a raw oil storage tank, which is number 5. This portion of the system provides the raw oil used in the production of biodiesel. Conversion of vegetable oil to biodiesel occurs in the reaction tank, number 6 as shown. Alcohol and hydroxide are combined in a separate mix tank at number 7. The solid hydroxide is dissolved into the alcohol by mixing vigorously in a closed loop. This is done using a specially designed pump shown at number 9 and the eductor nozzle, which is number 10. This is attached to the return line of the loop inside the mix tank. When the reaction is complete, the same pump is used to transfer the biodiesel and glycerin to a 500-gallon settling tank, number 8, which then allows the two to separate with gravity. The glycerin is removed off the bottom of the tank. The remaining fuel can then be tested for quality, passed through a final filter, and then used as diesel fuel on the farm.
State Line Farms are a really innovative place because they were the first on-farm biodiesel plant to get going in Vermont. And John Williamson is a really smart guy who figured out how to grow all the ingredients to make both the oil part of it, and also he's been working on growing the alcohol crops because those are the two main things you need to make biodiesel. The whole idea with the State Line Farm project really was to have a community-based biodiesel operation because there's a lot of different things that can go into it and out of it. So for example, some dairy farmers might grow soybeans and they just want the meal back for the cows. So when you take the seeds and you press it to get the oil out, and then you make biodiesel, that could stay on the biodiesel farm, but the meal would go back to the dairy farm. Other people want the oil back because they're using vegetable oil either for human consumption or, you know, to burn directly. So the idea is to get a group of farms within a 20-30-40 mile radius so that they're collaborating instead of competing. You know, the whole idea behind this was that there's a different way to go about making fuels and having big industrial plants, which are the way biodiesel is made now, in like 30 million or 60 million gallon plants. And so you have lots of commodity soybean farmers. They send tons and tons of seeds to that plant, and you know, the biodiesel is made and it goes off to be sold, you know, at gas stations and stuff, and the farmers may not even get the fuel back. So the idea here was to create something that's really oriented both with the inputs and the outputs in the community. So they grow the stuff to make the fuel, and then essentially they're getting to use it, so they're making their own fuel is what it comes down to, rather than making it for, you know, a big industrial entity that's going to sell it to commodity markets.
A tomato may travel 3,500 miles to get to our home. It may also travel 50 feet. The graph on the top shows the distance a supermarket tomato may travel compared to one that is local. Local is shown by 30 miles, as if you were to go to a local farm for fresh produce. The graph on the bottom shows the CO2 emissions required to ship a tomato from Central America compared to driving your own car to a local farm to pick up your groceries. Not only does fresh, local, organic food taste better, it is better for the environment. Walker Farm in Dummerston, Vermont is certified organic. They are very energy conscious and try to be as green as they can when it comes to their own greens. Here is Jack Mannix to tell us more.
Well, I think, you know, one of the reasons that we have chosen to be certified organic, mm-hmm. is the main reason I would think is that this farm's been in our family since 1790, and we want to leave it a better place. So mm-hmm. we think that, you know, by not, you know, pounding it with chemicals, and you know, there's been a lot of research that shows, you know, a lot of problems with And also, you know, we have kids, and we have kids coming into the store, and it makes you feel real good to know that they're not eating something that could be potentially damaging to them in the long run. You know, there's a number of ways that, you know, we save energy. We did have a solar installation put on one of our barns, which is really nice because that sort of runs, that pays for 23 greenhouses, really. In the winter, well, we build credits, it's net metering, and in the winter, late winter, we tend to use those credits up, but in the summer, when we're not using as much power in the greenhouses, we build a lot of credits. So it's pretty much breaks even on that, which is nice. The latest thing we've been doing is out of our 23 greenhouses, we have about four of them that are high tech, that have a lot of energy saving technology in them. They have energy curtains, which are pretty cool. They're computer controlled, and they come over a half hour before sunset, and they keep the heat, you know, down low. It's like a aluminum threaded curtain. That's really neat. And then it opens up about a half hour before sunrise, so that keeps the greenhouse warmer. And we have insulated floors and a knee wall around each greenhouse. We have weather stations that are computer controlled to tell the greenhouse when to open and when to close. You know, it's that safe. So there's two areas we try to be efficient on. That's labor and energy. We try to on labor. We try to hire good people and pay them a little more, and not hire as many. And they get the job done without having to do it over again. And then on energy, we need to keep trying to reduce our costs because that keeps going up. But in the greenhouse, we cut our pesticide use by 90-95% by using what they call biologicals. And those are good bugs that fight bad bugs. I guess, you know, the only other thing I can think of with energy is turn off the lights.
The farming and forestry technique of permaculture has taken root across the globe. The Agroforestry Research Trust is based in England, and this is their forest garden.
A forest garden is a three-dimensional garden of useful plants. So there's trees, shrubs, ground cover plants, perennial plants, all designed to maximize beneficial interactions and minimize competition, designed to be sustainable in the long term by having plants that feed other plants, by having plants for bees to sustain a pollinating population. Sustainable from other ways too, because most of the plants are perennial, you know, trees or smaller plants. And so the soil is not dug most of the time. And not digging the soil is really important in terms of sustainability, because every time you dig the soil, a load of carbon goes into the air.
Vermont is covered in wooded forests. All of this land is economically really only used for three things: maple syrup, firewood, and for hunting purposes. Tad Montgomery has proposed an agroforestry project that would make the forests of Vermont more healthy and productive by expanding the range of products that are grown in them. This is an interview conducted with Tad, as he tells us more about what permaculture is and how it is an energy-efficient, more progressive ideology.
Permaculture is a global design philosophy that seeks to develop sustainable landscapes. It has a series of design principles, and then a series of ethics, and many, many different techniques. Where most of our agriculture now is based in what's called monocrop. So you have a field of corn, and that's all you have is corn. With permaculture, you have a landscape that can have 100 or even 1,000 species of plants in it. And it's a highly managed, highly intentional landscape that can be much, much more productive than the monoculture type of agriculture.
So where does the energy to do all this come from?
The current electricity system in place in the United States is based on a 120-year-old central grid system involving both demand and supply-side technologies. The current grid uses energy from a variety of sources, primarily coal and natural gas, which accounted for 67% of electricity produced in 2010. 86% of this electricity was generated in large-scale power plants, again as of 2010. Issues with the current system include an aging infrastructure. More than 70% of the U.S.'s coal plants are over 30 years old, and 33% are over 40 years old. The Rocky Mountain Institute estimates that it will cost $7.5 trillion to replace these aging plants. Another issue addresses the environmental constraints, primarily regarding the current U.S. electricity sector's high carbon emissions. We stand at an important turning point in our energy future, at a time in which many options are being discussed.
A conservative alternative to this current system, as proposed by the author Amory Levins in his book Reinventing Fire, is to migrate. This plan would be to retire old plants that emit carbon, build new nuclear plants, and invest in new carbon capture and sequestration technology. This would be a way of eliminating carbon emissions without changing the entire energy paradigm already in place. The goal would be to build 3 nuclear plants and implement 9 CSS systems per year for the next 40 years. Research has found that CSS is not really a viable option. As expensive as it is theoretical, this clean coal is not really developed enough to be considered a real contender for our energy's future.
As for nuclear power, we know that many people in this area disagree with nuclear energy on principle, based upon its high costs, perceived dangers, and the issue with waste disposal. However, nuclear energy has long been a part of our community and our economic system, and many people still view nuclear as a viable option. Here's Aiden to tell you about innovative nuclear technology that he feels could be a safer, small-scale solution for Brattleboro.
Nuclear energy has gained somewhat of a negative stigma over the past few decades. In that time, we have seen a nuclear industry that is expensive and inefficient, with a somewhat questionable safety record. Many people are deeply opposed to nuclear energy, some to the point of being outright phobic. But most likely, much of what you know about nuclear power is based off vastly outmoded technology. Most of the tech we see today is 40 years old. 40 years ago, cars were unsafe too. But, as in cars, new nuclear technologies are safe and efficient. Some are positively infallible. Over the next few minutes, I'm going to introduce you to the most promising of these technologies for your consideration. Please believe me when I say that I am not hiding anything from you. There are no catches. I am not neglecting to tell you about some hidden cost or any nuclear super wastes. Let's start with a simple twist on something you're maybe already familiar with, the small-scale uranium reactor. The principle is pretty simple. Start a nuclear chain reaction in a uranium fuel, control the reaction, and use the heat it generates. But as the accidents at Chernobyl and Fukushima showed, controlling the reaction is not always easy. But those plants were built decades ago. Today we know better. Current small-scale designs incorporate liquid lead medium instead of water. When water passes its boiling point, it tries to turn to gas, creating steam. Steam has 1,000 times the volume of water. And when a reactor fails, this huge pressure causes it to explode, as we've seen in past accidents. But lead has a much higher boiling point. The reactor can operate at similar or, in fact, higher temperatures while maintaining low pressures. This makes it much more difficult for explosions to happen. Higher temperatures also allow for increased efficiency. When light water reactors explode, they propel dangerous radioactive fuels and wastes into the environment. If a lead-cooled reactor were to melt down, it would preserve the materials inside the heavy lead coolant, making dispersal more difficult.
And this is a Generation 3?
It's a Generation 3, yes. It's the first of the commercially available Generation 3s.
Do you feel that this is a sufficiently safe technology?
I think so.
Moving on, I would like to introduce you to the accelerator-driven subcritical reactor, known more simply as an energy amplifier. This system consists of a particle accelerator continuously firing neutrons at a nuclear fuel. This allows it to cause fission in and gain energy from sources that do not normally fission. Energy amplifiers are fundamentally different from uranium reactors in that instead of controlling a chain reaction, as in almost every other type of reactor, it initiates and sustains a reaction that otherwise would not happen. The reaction requires active input of energy. If something were to go wrong, since the beam has a finite maximum output, it is absolutely impossible for an energy amplifier to melt down.
If it's subcritical, it means that if somebody turns off the power, it stops. Mm-hmm. Of course, that's an advantage. If you want to turn your reactor off, all you got to do is flick the switch.
Mm-hmm. The only downside to energy amplifiers is that they're an undeveloped technology, and it is unknown whether they can be shrunk down to town scale. An energy amplifier can use uranium, but it can also use plutonium and other nuclear wastes. In this manner, an energy amplifier can actually reduce the world's backlog of hazardous nuclear waste. Energy amplifiers can also use thorium as fuel. Thorium is superior to uranium in every way. It is 1/4 as radioactive as uranium, though I should mention that uranium is not nearly as radioactive as uranium waste. Thorium is more than 3 times as abundant as uranium. Thorium cannot by itself fission. It is impossible to make a bomb out of thorium. As a fuel, thorium has an energy concentration 30 times greater than enriched uranium, and 200 times that of natural uranium. Thorium is so energy dense that you could hold your entire lifetime's worth of energy in your hands in the form of thorium. And thorium is safe enough that you could do it without dangerously irradiating yourself, though you might want to wear gloves. Unlike uranium waste, which can remain dangerous for millions of years, 83% of thorium waste is safe in 10 years, with the remaining waste becoming safe in just 300.
It produces only 1% as much waste as the conventional reactors and produces no plutonium.
Now that we've gone over thorium, let's talk about our final type of reactor, the liquid fluoride thorium reactor. The LFTR is the most promising of all nuclear technologies. It involves exposing a thorium salt fluoride solution to a critical neutron source. In this way, the LFTR breeds new uranium fuel for itself. While not quite as perfectly safe as the energy amplifier, the LFTR's unique design allows for a number of safety features that permit a level of safety unheard of in any other reactor barring completely subcritical systems such as the energy amplifier. The LFTR uses no water. In fact, the coolant is mixed with the fuel and uses the same system, so a separate cooling system is unnecessary. This makes the configuration simpler and thus safer. The lack of any high-pressure water also reduces leaks, reduces corrosion, and makes catastrophic failures unlikely. This also allows the reactor structures to be built much smaller, because most of the bulk of light water reactors comes from pressure protections. The reactor's high temperature allows for passive convection circulation, meaning there need not be any moving parts inside the fuel coolant loop. Again, simpler and safer. The liquid state of the fuel allows for impurities such as xenon to be removed easily. These impurities normally make reactors more unpredictable. Xenon was a contributing factor at Chernobyl. Finally, the reactor can be designed with a solid salt plug, which will passively melt in the event of an overheat or loss of power. This would allow for the fuel to drain by gravity into a pool or circuit, which would spread the fuel such that the reaction would stop. LFTRs also produce dangerous and easily detectable uranium-232 along with uranium-233, which makes the fuel highly undesirable for use in weapons. Both LFTR reactors and energy amplifiers use all of their fuel, making them 100% efficient. This is stupendous compared to current tech light water reactors, which are just 0.5% efficient. Before we conclude, I have a couple more things to say. I understand that perhaps you don't want nuclear energy to have a place in your community. That's okay. It is true that most of your energy needs can be met with the technologies my colleagues have come here to tell you about. And while many of those technologies have nuclear beat in one way or another, no other technology can match nuclear's possibility of combined cost-effectiveness, small physical footprint, reliability, and, yes, safety. It should be said, though, that the latter two technologies that I talked about are underdeveloped. Even if you wanted to, you would not immediately be able to purchase a reactor like the ones I have talked about. Only 2 LFTR reactors have ever been operated. Both were experiments briefly operated 50 years ago in the same lab. Only 1 energy amplifier has been built, also a laboratory experiment. 10 years from now, you might be able to buy an off-the-shelf LFTR from China, perhaps an energy amplifier sometime after that. But research in this country is mostly stagnant. So, unlike my classmates, I'm not so much here to tell you about what you could or should be doing. I'm here to tell you what you can look forward to in the future. And if you really want these technologies available to you, make your voice heard. Tell your friends, call your representative, get excited. In conclusion, compared to currently utilized uranium technology, new nuclear technologies can use techniques 200 times as efficient, with fuel less radioactive and 30 times as efficient. Their waste is dangerous for at most hundreds of years instead of millions, and they are perfectly, or almost perfectly, safe. Thank you for your time. I hope you'll take these amazing technologies into consideration. Also, in closing, I should mention that, since nuclear technologies actually create heat, not electricity, any of these technologies can be used to supply heat for a central heating plan, which I believe my colleagues previously talked about. Using the heat in this way is much more efficient than converting the energy to electricity.
Another option many people have discussed is the idea of turning towards more renewable energy sources. When people discuss renewables, they often think about wind and solar. But before we get to those, we would like to introduce some other lesser-known alternatives. Here's Kyle to tell you more about geothermal energy and air source heat pumps, another source of renewable energy.
We have a very special guest today from Washington, D.C. We'd like to welcome Congressman Peter Welsh to our program. Good afternoon, Congressman.
Good afternoon. It's good to be with you.
In January, I spoke with Congressman Peter Welsh regarding his recent legislation, the Home Heating and Cooling Efficiency Act, which would expand the tax credit up to $500 for the purchase of heat pumps, or 10% of the total cost of the product. He gave us this statement about his bill, Act H.R. 3772.
The Homes Act was a way to help folks who were willing to invest some of their own money into insulating their home, making it tight and energy efficient. And the plan of Homes was to give a federal tax credit to folks who were willing to put their own money into heating efficiency installations in their home. So it was a partnership between the government and the individuals who are homeowners.
Geothermal energy is thermal energy that is stored in the earth. This energy can be harnessed for both electricity generation and heat generation. One way of harnessing the earth's energy is through heat pumps. There are two types of heat pumps. We will start with ground source. Ground source heat pumps are heating and cooling systems that transfer heat either to or from the ground. It uses the earth as both a heat source and a heat sink. In the winter, when the air is cold, the pump takes heat from the ground and uses it to heat the air. In the summer, the pump takes the hot air and pumps it into the ground. This is made possible by the relatively constant temperature of the Earth's crust year-round. Air source heat pumps haven't been around as long, but are cheaper to install and much more efficient. An air source heat pump accomplishes the same thing through a different source. These pumps take in the air and the heat it has to offer. They can retrieve heat from even the coldest New England temperatures. The air is compressed and condensed, and the heat that is retrieved is pumped into the space in need. Both of these heat pumps accomplish the same goal, but air source heat pumps are much more costly.
What impresses me about the heat pumps is first that it's a totally different way of using energy. So rather than using the electricity to generate heat, you're using the electricity to transfer energy, in the case of an air source heat pump, from the outside to the inside of the space that you're trying to heat, which is a much more efficient way of using the energy that you have. Decided to do was to take an older three-bedroom home. So this is a home that was probably built in the 1920s.
Yep.
It's a old three-bedroom house, and I decided to see if it makes any sense and is practical to install a heat pump and have it work well in that scenario. So now this older house now has the ability to have air conditioning. It has the heat and it has the hot water all provided by this heat pump. So in this, it turns out at first look through these colder months like the electric bill for providing the heat and hot water, at least at this time of year, is in the vicinity of $100 per month is being consumed by that system. That's about what it would cost, or a little more than it would cost, just to provide hot water in a three-bedroom house. So to get heat out of that as well, it appears that it is being highly effective.
Here you can see the heat energy data from a local home in Vermont. The graph shows the kilowatt hours used per month for an entire year, starting November 2012 and ending in November 2013. From this data, it was calculated that the amount of money spent on heat during the year's time in this home was $478.50. For the same data, it would cost $416.98 to heat with propane, and $128.79 to heat with wood. Heating with the heat pump is comparable in cost to heating with propane, but not at the expense of the environment. Heating with a non-renewable resource is becoming tricky by itself, but the added delivery costs, tank repairs, and inspections make propane heating less and less desirable.
Biogas is another lesser-known source of renewable energy. Here are Katie and Carolina to tell you more.
Life needs energy. Energy requires fuel.
fuel plus O2 yields CO2 plus H2O plus energy, but fuel costs money. And it creates greenhouse gases, which are bad for life. So why don't we look for free sources that will reduce greenhouse gas emissions? Food waste is free. By some estimates, Americans currently waste 40% of the food that they produce. Speaking of waste, poop is free too. So how do we turn the waste into fuel? We turn to our friends, the bacteria. Bacteria love to eat bio waste, and it turns out that their waste is methane, which is something we can definitely use. Methane plus oxygen yields CO2 plus H2O plus energy. So we put the waste in a device called a biodigester along with some bacteria, where they go to work doing what they do best. Collect the methane to use for energy. The leftover waste can be used as a nutritious fertilizer for our crops. As an added bonus, this fertilizer is virtually scentless. Mission accomplished. But can this really help us here in Vermont, and if so, how much?
One thing we do have a lot of in Vermont is cows. Here in Windham County, we have about 8,200 cows, which produce 50 pounds of manure per day. For those of you without a calculator, that equals about 149,650,000 pounds per year. If you put all of that in a biodigester, we could produce over 2 billion cubic feet of methane. With that amount of methane, how much energy could we make? Well, 1 pound of manure can make 7,800 BTU of energy, so that equals over 1.2 billion BTU produced by the cows in Windham County each year, which can be converted to over 342 million kilowatt hours of electricity. How much is that? As of 2011, the average household used about 11,000 kilowatt hours per year. There are about 10,000 families living in Brattleboro and the surrounding area. With 342 million kilowatt hours produced by Windham County's cows, we could power the houses in Brattleboro and the surrounding area for about 3 years. Good job, cows!
Are there any biodigesters in Windham County? If so, where and what are they used for?
Windham County at the Goodell Farm in Westminster, they have an anaerobic digester that's running off manure. Brattleboro Wastewater Treatment Plant, which has an anaerobic digester to digest the leftover biosolids or sewage sludge. And that's making electricity also.
Are there any future plans for biogas?
There are some studies that have been done. I would say that Windham Solid Waste Management District has probably done the most work in that area. We had a graduate student project for Marlboro College Graduate School last year do a feasibility study of digesting food waste. Much as Brattleboro currently collects food waste for composting, that material could be put into an anaerobic digestion vessel to extract the methane, generate power, and then still have a byproduct that could be used as a soil amendment or compost. I believe there are some other companies in the region that have looked at biogas from their leftover materials. One is Commonwealth Dairy that makes the Greek yogurt, and also Grafton Village Cheese.
If a biogas plant was to be built in Windham County, what location would fit best?
I believe that right at Windham Solid Waste Management District's property on Old Ferry Road, where the closed landfill is for a number of reasons. First of all, the solid waste district's mandate is to recycle. And so with the new state recycling law for organic, we would have a good location.
We've been studying the use of biogas in Kristianstad, Sweden. Kristianstad has been using biogas for the past 20 years. What's so different politically and economically about Vermont that biogas hasn't been used as long?
From biogas, from organic matter, there's not much of that happening in North America. I have been to some biogas plants that make CNG for fuels. You might be interested in a company called Quasar, Q-U-A-S-A-R. I went to a plant of theirs in several plants in Ohio recently. And that comes from organic waste, organic materials, specifically manure, sewage sludge, which is called biosolids. In Europe, through the European Union, they set some very aggressive recycling standards quite a few years ago. So they were mandating organics and created a market for it. So the technology's proven, it's happening. It's just that we've had less expensive landfill disposal rates here in North America. We've had large landfills that are open for many decades. But that's changing, just like in Vermont. So Vermont is the first state in the United States to require that food waste be separated by residents, and that'll start in 2020. But starting next year, large generators like supermarkets or hospitals or colleges that produce about 2 tons a week have to start separating it and recycling. It will happen in Vermont.
What about using biogas as fuel for transportation?
Okay, that's called compressed natural gas. In the industry we say CNG, compressed natural gas, which exists already. There's compressed natural gas in Vermont right now for vehicles, but it's piped in natural gas from fracking and oil sources. Shale. Okay. So you can compress that and put it in tanks and power motor vehicles with it. And there's bus fleets, truck fleets, Casella Waste, which is a big waste hauler in Vermont, is converting much of their fleet.
The most popular and well-known renewable energy sources are wind and solar. Here are Nick and Linnea to give you more information on the reality of wind and solar in a community.
When people think of renewable energy, wind and solar are the names that come to mind first. Solar and wind energy are clean, renewable energy sources that convert energy into electricity and feed it into the grid, the network of transmission lines that transport energy from production sites like solar farms or nuclear power plants to consumption sites like homes and offices.
On a solar farm, the solar panels convert large amounts of the sun's energy into electricity, which then gets sent to a main inverter. After that, a substation reduces the high-voltage electricity to something that the grid can manage.
However, a lot of solar systems are residential. The main difference between solar farms and residential solar systems is that residential solar systems don't send their electricity directly into the grid, they feed it into an attached electrical system. Solar panels that produce electricity are called photovoltaic, or PV for short, and those that produce hot water are called solar thermal.
There are a lot of other benefits to getting your electricity from solar panels. If you're looking into installing your own solar panel, a term that will come up is payback. Since solar panels will generate electricity that would otherwise be taken from the grid and therefore paid for, they save money and eventually will save the money that they were worth. Installing solar panels also increases home value while decreasing your carbon footprint. Not only this, but net metering introduces another financial upside. Net metering is a system that allows surplus energy generated by on-site power sources, such as solar panels, to be sold to the grid and further reduce your electricity bill.
So community solar is a concept where a lot of different people own a system that's located in a very good solar location. And it provides an opportunity for people who may not have good exposure on their roofs or in their yard to still make use of solar energy.
A major benefit of small-scale renewables is their ability to feed into microgrids, small-scale grids that are powered locally and can function independently from the macro grid, usually just called the grid. By producing and distributing power this way, microgrids save energy and money. The macro grid has a lot of issues that can be solved by using microgrids, such as outages that are easily caused by storms and other disruptions and that cost the government billions of dollars per year. Isolating the power production and distribution process allows places to customize their production to fit demand, which is much more efficient than the centralized grid's method of creating as much electricity as possible and allowing whatever is unused to go to waste. Wind energy is a very low-cost power source that turns the kinetic energy of wind into electricity. Most wind turbines have blades that are rotated by the wind and turn a generator, making electricity. The electricity is very high in voltage, so it gets sent to a substation before being distributed by the grid. However, not all wind turbines use blades. The Saffonian is a new kind of wind turbine that has yet to reach the market. The new design allows the Saffonian to generate electricity at almost 90% efficiency, as opposed to the 40% average efficiency that regular turbines have.
The Saffonian is a good example of advancements in technology that allow renewables to be a more reasonable approach to energy in our society. Because of the high costs of blades and other materials that aren't necessary for the Saffonian's design, the energy it produces will cost much less. In fact, the price of wind energy and solar energy has been dropping due to advancements in technology and financial benefits for a long time. For example, people with personal solar panels can often save money on their taxes because of government incentives for clean energy. Since 1976, when each watt was around $100, the cost of PV solar power has been dropping steadily. In just 4 years, from 2008 to 2012, prices went from $4 per watt to only 70 cents, and they're continuing to plummet. Wind energy is becoming less and less expensive as well, but not quite as quickly as solar. In the 28 years between 1984 and 2012, price per megawatt has gone from roughly $400 to almost $70. Wind and solar energy isn't a futuristic dream either. In fact, there are many towns that are already operating largely on wind, solar, or a combination of the two. These towns often have benefits such as a large job market, reduced energy costs, a small carbon footprint, and an economy that doesn't have to worry about energy.
The town of Freiburg is sort of like a solar dream. In this German town, people earn money by selling their personally generated electricity back to the grid. There are laws that dictate how much energy new houses are allowed to waste, and the town produces 10 million kilowatts per year from solar panels. Freiburg is known as one of the sunniest cities in Germany, with over 1,800 hours of sunshine annually. But compared with the 2,292 hours that we get in Vermont, this isn't much.
Another town benefiting from renewable energy is Samsø, Denmark. An island twice the size of Manhattan, it's able to completely power itself and 20% of Denmark with its 21 wind turbines, both onshore and off. Although it costs millions of dollars to install the turbines, sales of electricity are bringing in $80 million annually, and farmers who own turbines can make up to $4,000 per day. Interestingly, Samsø has a lower average wind speed than we do here in Brattleboro. While we're getting winds of roughly 21.2 miles per hour, Samsø's average wind speed is around 16 miles per hour. However, we experience very low wind speeds for 5 months of the year, making it impractical to rely entirely on wind power. This is a good example of why it's important to diversify energy sources, particularly when using renewables. Things like daylight hours and wind speeds change quite a bit, unlike coal plants that are consistently managing coal use. A diverse group of energy sources leads to a more predictable and reliable one. After looking at these towns that are benefiting so much from wind and solar energy, we decided to go to our friend Alex Wilson over in Dummerston to learn about clean energy in Brattleboro.
So I'm Alex Wilson. I've been a resident of Dummerston for 32 years. I'm on the Dummerston Energy Committee. I write about renewable energy, energy efficiency, building technology, and environmental issues, have for a long time. Well, a good approach would be to contact Integrated Solar or contract Sovereign, another company that does community systems, and find out if they have any systems in the works and, you know, how they can sign up.
And how do you think the shift to cleaner energy Brattleboro is going to play out over the next few decades?
Well, statewide, there's an energy plan in place that calls for a pretty aggressive goal for converting the state to renewable energy sources. In Brattleboro, I think we're ahead of the curve. Brattleboro has a very active energy committee. They've been working with the school system to provide solar power for the Brattleboro schools. So I'm cautiously optimistic. I mean, it's a big challenge to talk about that large a percentage of a community's energy needs met through renewables. But I think it's possible, and certainly I'm working toward that, and a lot of people in the community are working toward it.
The question remains, which is the most logical direction to go? None of these options by itself is a solution. It is combined that they present the best path. The final piece of Amory Lovin's book discusses just this, the solution that can be found in the combination.
I'm looking for energy everywhere. I'm looking for energy.
My head's up in the sky, it's higher than the clouds are. I like to look up at the stars and wonder how far. From what I hear, about a billion babies are delivered every day. It's always like the planet is a clown car.
I'm looking for energy everywhere. I'm looking for energy.
Teacher said this party started with a loud bang. The women ears are ringing, I don't hear a sound, man. I'm steady looking at the crowd like a proud dad. For coming out instead of clicking on a mouse.